Our coffee breaks with researchers aim to spread knowledge about regional development and innovation. By sending a camera around the world, we present you with different angles and insights on the topic. We ask researchers directly and in a personal manner about their work. We want to make scientific knowledge accessible to all. Hi, welcome to Coffee Break with Researchers. Today, I'm having a coffee break with Stuart Dawley. He's the head of geography and senior lecturer in economic geography at the Center for Urban and Regional Development Studies, CURST, at Newcastle University in the United Kingdom. Hello, Stuart. Thank you for accepting my invitation to a coffee break. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you.
Today, I'm having a Colombian black coffee. Which coffee are you having?
Black filter.
I am interested in a paper of yours, which is about how leading firms can be attracted and embedded in regions in order to promote regional development. Could you please tell me what the paper was about?
Yeah, sure. So what we're looking at is this idea within the global production network literature that regional development, this sort of dynamic process of regional development, occurs when the strategic needs of these big global production networks through which our global economy is increasingly organized now, so the kind of supply chains around which you have big dominant lead firms and their organizational activities are ever more spread across markets and production sites. Regional development occurs when the strategic needs of the global production networks locate particular regional assets in particular places which can be valorized to create regional development. And what our paper tries to do is to look in more detail at this idea of strategic coupling, when the networks and their strategic needs lock together in harness upon particular regional assets. And crucially, it's understanding what regions can do to try and improve their chances of attracting in these strategic coupling investments. And in particular, what we're trying to do as well is just redress the balance of the literature, which to date has been very firm-centric. So the regional or the strategic couplings are very much driven by the strategic needs of these global production networks seeking out new locations. But what we want to also do is actually look at what the regions are doing and what strategic agency the regions have to actually reach out and pull the networks in to create these sorts of investment opportunities. And in particular, it can mean the growth of new industries and new growth paths for cities and regions.
And what is this strategic agency? What kind of recommendations can you provide?
Well, the strategic agency, in many ways, can often be quite political in terms of establishing some form of alignment between the policy initiatives, often the political channels that are connecting the local and regional scale with the national scale. So in the Humber region, for example, we realized that the degree of alignment which was developed between the vision of the local coalition of actors that developed around the Humber and how that aligned with the national energy market policy and industrial policy at the time was really important. So in terms of thinking about the policy implications, it is to try and think through the levels of alignment in terms of thematic alignment, in terms of sector promotion, but also just in terms of alignment within broader policy initiatives. So the local and regional actors are connecting to almost the flow and political support at the national level. We also realise that within the Humber case, the local authorities in the Humber region, especially around Hull, were able to actually exercise quite a lot of strategic and tactical political agency due to the fact that they have quite a few politicians with national level influence who have local constituencies in the Humber. And I think the political side of attracting in inward investment is often overlooked. So I think that came through as well. Another key finding that we realized as well was that the coupling process, this process of attracting in an inward investor into a particular region, doesn't happen overnight. It is and can often be a protracted process. in what we saw with the example of Siemens coming to the Humber region, is that having chosen the Humber as its main preferred site in signing a memorandum of understanding, it took a further 3 years for the actual investment to be fully confirmed. And that was because the national government in the UK changed, the energy market policy became less generous, there was less certainty in the long-term vision for Siemens in terms of the offshore wind market. So therefore Siemens began to reconsider their investment commitment to Hull. And for that 3 years, what we saw was that the regional institutions need to be very adaptable, very flexible, very responsive to actually broker and secure what was the memorandum of understanding to invest, to actually make the investment happen.
This is a fascinating paper. Could you please summarize your findings?
Well, because we were trying to take more seriously the sort of strategic agency that the regions can bring to this strategic coupling process, we try to unpack in more detail what the literature calls regional institutions. And these are the actors, the policy initiatives, the roles of the state across the national, local and regional level, the sorts of institutional organisations that are actually doing the work of trying to attract in the strategic investments from the global production networks. And within the literature, within the global production literature, especially its latest developments around GPN 2.0, the regional institution analytical category is a kind of cohesive, overarching, multi-scalar understanding of what regional institutions are. And that does include cities, regions, local authorities, institutional actors, organizations promoting economic development, but it also includes nation states and supranational governance bodies. And what we think is, it's probably, whilst it's welcome to have a multi-scalar understanding, in some ways it maybe suppresses some of the scalar politics and institutional contexts that are involved in these different actors working across and within these different scales. So what our researchers try to do is take one example of a strategic coupling. In this case, it's the development of an industrial path in the Humber region of the UK around offshore wind. And we've looked at trying to understand the role of the regional institutions at play in attracting in, which was Siemens, the largest wind turbine manufacturer in the world, to come in and develop a blade manufacturing facility in the Humber. And we unpacked that broader regional institutional category that's within the literature to actually look more specifically at the roles of different institutional actors and policy organisations at different levels, whether it be the local, the national, and actually try and understand their roles a little bit more differently and with a more nuance to get the strategic agency that they have in trying to attract in an inward investor.
This is a very detailed project, so I imagine this must be a very important personal motivation. Could you tell me which was it?
Yeah, there's two levels of personal motivation, I think. Conceptually, we have been very interested in a parallel set of debates and theoretical contributions in evolutionary economic geography that looks at the role of path creation. And within that, transplantation and inward investment is seen as a key mechanism of path creation. And I think what we've tried to do is maybe think through some of the links between that set of literature and the global production network set of literature in terms of this idea of strategic coupling. There's clearly some overlap there. And myself and Danny McKinnon and Andy Pike and Andy Cumbers have also written a similar paper that tries more specifically to connect the GPN strategic coupling with the evolutionary economic geography path creation literature. So conceptually, that was one motivation. Secondly, I had a very personal motivation in that the region in question, which has been able to secure the strategic investment in offshore wind, is actually the region where I grew up and I'm from. and it's a region that has struggled economically since the decline of its maritime industries. So I was actually quite motivated personally to try and understand how and why the Humber region had been successful in securing this new path of growth around offshore wind.
Thank you for this insightful chat. It was really nice to have you here in my coffee break. I wish you all the best for your future research and I hope to see you soon again. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you for watching. If you are interested in more details about this research, find here the link to the academic publication. Thank you and see you next time. Bye-bye.